Howdy, my anatomy friends. It's Bowles. I'm here today to talk a little bit about the male and the female differences in terms of how sperm and eggs are produced. So this picture, although it might look like the beach in the ocean, is actually an egg. And these are the sperm on the outside in the process of fertilization. It's a pretty big picture there. It looks pretty interesting. So it's a good start for our lesson today. As you know, because I asked you to explore this, there's a lot of differences between the male and the female process of gamete production. The gonads, which are the ovaries and the testes, are different in the male and the female functionally, and obviously structurally as well. There's only one gamete per month matured in the female body, and that will allow it to become the zygote if it's fertilized, but the male can produce sperm throughout his lifetime, and lots of them, so half a billion per day. Looking at the male, we'll specifically talk a little bit about the testis. Testis is singular. Testes are plural, and men have two. And then, of course, the sperm are produced here, matured here in the epididymis. They're going to travel here along the ductus deferens when ejaculation is going to occur. Adding to it fluids from the seminal vesicle, the prostate, the bulbourethral glands, and then out through the urethra and deposited in the female's body. So just a little bit about the testes before we talk about sperm production. Inside of a male baby in utero at 2 months gestation, the testes are actually internal. And if you look at this progression here, slowly they descend. And they descend through what's called the spermatic cord, and a channel here, a canal, the inguinal canal, and they go into the scrotum. And that is because production of sperm occurs best outside the body. The temperature is proper for that. I want to talk just for a second about testis or testes and what a testicle is. So this right here is a testicle. I'm sorry. This right here is a testis, one testy. This whole structure, though, including the muscles, the ligaments, and all of the skin here, the scrotum, this is called a testicle. So the testicle is the whole structure, the testis, plus all the blood vessels, skin, and muscles. Okay, just to make that distinction between testicle and testis. Also be aware that we talked about how the testicle is outside the body. The testis descends into the testicle before birth normally or slightly after birth, and that is because sperm need to be produced at a lower temperature. In fact, they need to be about 1 to 2 degrees lower in order to be healthily made, and that's why they live or rest outside the body, and there's a muscle there called the cremaster muscle in the male's testicle that keeps the right temperature. So it contracts in colder conditions and relaxes in warmer conditions in order to keep the testicle producing sperm. So inside each testis, you have lots and lots of these coiled up tubules, some of them as much as almost a meter in length, 80 centimeters in length. These are called seminiferous tubules, and that is where the actual sperm are produced. So as we get to begin to talk about spermatogenesis, this is showing you the layers and where the various cells are in relation to sperm being produced. So on the very inside of the seminiferous tubules, closer to the wall, this is where the beginnings of the cell divisions occur. And as you move toward the lumen or the inside where there's an opening, you actually see the mature sperm there. Okay. There are lots and lots of these seminiferous tubules coiled into each testis. And the way it works is this, and you have this handout. So I would like you to label this all up and get it ready. So this is the primary cell called the spermatogonia that makes the sperm, and men throughout their life have many, many spermatogonia in their testis or testes, and these spermatogonia divide into two cells called primary spermatocytes. So the primary spermatocyte here is actually going to be, this one stays, and this one goes through the production of sperm. And basically it goes through mitosis in this first part here. So this is a mitotic division or mitosis. The next slide will go over the actual words here. So mitosis first, And then after it goes through mitosis, it begins to go through meiosis, and that is two divisions to produce four spermatids, okay? So spermatogonium produces primary spermatocytes, which produce secondary spermatocytes, which produce spermatids, which will differentiate or form sperm. And we'll talk about the sperm and the shape in just a minute. So here's my slide with the words on it for you guys. So showing, by the way, this happens starting at puberty for a male all the way throughout life, and men produce about a half a billion sperm a day consistently throughout life. Sperm production will decrease as age comes along, but men are still able to father children at whatever age as long as they have healthy sperm. So this shows you again the chromosomes and what they look like. We start with a cell that has 46 chromosomes, so it's a diploid cell. It divides in mitosis, so that means it forms two daughters that also have 46 chromosomes. And then we end up, as we begin meiosis here, we're going to have 46 again, doubling, and then these guys. And then eventually we're going to come up with 23 chromosomes in each haploid spermatid, which differentiates or matures into four sperm. And keep in mind that this is happening in lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of spermatogonium in order to make a half a billion sperm a day. Very different than female. So when those sperm or spermatids are formed, they're more like a cell, but then as they mature or differentiate, they end up forming the actual sperm or spermatozoan, and they will change cytoplasmically in various ways, reorganize to end up with the DNA here in the head, the nucleus, and this thing called the acrosomal cap. The acrosomal cap is full of enzymes to help the sperm, once it gets to the egg's follicle, to digest through the follicle and then penetrate into the follicle. And the midpiece here has mitochondria for allowing the flagellum, which is the tail, to be able to propel the sperm. Okay, so the structure of the sperm is very important to its function. And of course, the sperm will be implanted into the female's body right around here, because the vagina is the place where during intercourse the penis deposits the sperm right here, and this little tiny opening in the cervix will allow them to move up, and they'll begin to move up and into and through the uterus and into the fallopian tubes. Now remember, there are two fallopian tubes, and the sperm don't know where they're heading, they're just heading up. And then somewhere along in the fallopian tube, usually right about in here, is where fertilization typically occurs, where the egg and the sperm will meet. Okay. So in the female, just looking a little bit here, what it looks like when the womb or the uterus is being used to house a developing baby, that's this structure here. Very strong muscular organ, which acts as a womb also and houses a baby during development or gestation. So talk a little bit about the female and how this occurs in the female. Of course, females' bodies, not only do they produce sex hormones and gametes, just like the male, the uterus has to support and protect a developing embryo and then nourish that baby until birth. So that's a big difference between the male and the female system, is that the uterus acts as the womb for a growing baby. So we're going to talk about egg production, or oogenesis, which occurs here in the gonad for the female, which is called the ovary. So here is the female system. Now, different than the male, it doesn't begin at puberty. It actually begins in utero. So when a baby girl is in her mother's womb, she's already beginning this process, and then it stops and waits until puberty to finish. Okay? So we start with an oogonium, which is the beginning or stem cell. But in a female, both oogonia become daughter cells, and both can go through the process of producing an ovum. In a male, one stays back and stays as a stem cell, and the other one goes through the process. In a female, the eggs do not regenerate. All the eggs that a female will have in her life are there when she's born. In fact, we'll learn about how they slowly over time die off. And that's why when women go through menopause, they don't have any more eggs to continue this process. So it starts before birth in a female. And the process in a female, again, starts with this oogonium. It divides into two primary oocytes. Again, these have 46 chromosomes like a regular body cell, this is mitosis. Then we go through meiosis, which is a double division, doubling the DNA again, dividing once, dividing twice, and eventually producing a 23-chromosome haploid ovum. So this is the egg. Now notice what happens. The division is not equal like in the male. The division is unequal, and what happens is the cytoplasm is given up so that the larger, more developed part of the female's meiosis is going to end up becoming the healthy ovum. That way there's a lot of cytoplasm and proteins for this ovum to survive the travel from the ovary all the way down the fallopian tube and to implant in the uterus. So this extra cytoplasm and organelles are needed for that process. So these little guys, which are polar bodies, actually give up their cytoplasm for the oocyte, and these disintegrate. Okay, so this part happens before birth, and then at puberty is where this stage, meiosis one, occurs. Okay, so we're going to have mitosis first, and then two meiotic divisions. This one's starting at puberty here. And then if you look at the diagram here, this says the very last stage doesn't occur until fertilization has occurred. So the oocyte is actually in a state of waiting to finish its very last division if fertilization occurs. Okay? So ovum production is called oogenesis. Again, we said it starts at birth and it continues until menopause. And this is the part I was talking about. Every female baby inside of her mother's womb has all of her oocytes, primary follicles, that are going to become oocytes before she's ever born. And then they start to degenerate over time, and only certain ones mature. By the time she gets to puberty, there may only be 400,000 left. And those are the ones that are going to be going through this process each month of maturing one ovum to be released, okay? And that's the ovum that could potentially be fertilized each month. So one of the things you should understand are the differences between spermatogenesis and oogenesis. The polar bodies are giving up that cytoplasm, remember, to allow that ovum to survive the journey. It's going to take 5 to 7 days for it to implant in the uterus. Okay, so that's pretty much the process. Hope it helps you to understand it. See you.